going to talk about how I believe energy is going to evolve over the next 50 or 100 years and some of the challenges that we face in providing enough energy for us all to meet the demands that we have on the quality of life, and also some of the constraints we have in terms of the ability to provide that energy, and the fact that if we're using fossil fuels, as we are largely now, the dangers that we have to the climate and the effects of climate change. So I call my segment Climate Change and Energy, Where Are We Going? So first of all, I thought we'd look at what are the main contenders in the energy space. And most of our energy now is provided by fossil fuels on the left. And you'll all be familiar with the fossil fuels. We've got oil and gas. And just in case you don't know what some of these things are, I don't have a demonstration of gas. It's just what's the hot air coming out of my mouth. But here's 2 milliliters of North Sea oil that you might want to, if you've never fondled North Sea oil, here's your chance. And I expect them to circulate and round and end up back on this table at the front, hopefully. And then, of course, there's coal. And here's a piece of coal. I'll keep that for the moment. It's quite difficult to get hold of coal nowadays. So these are the conventional fossil fuels. But then there's quite a lot of what's so-called unconventional fossil fuels that are there in the background that are more difficult to access, but are there if we need them. So probably the most famous that you'll have heard of is shale gas, which is gas that's in very tight rocks, very difficult to get out. That's why you have to fracture it, so-called fracking, to get it out. And there's a lot of controversy, of course, about whether we should use shale gas. But I'll come back to gas later. And then there's heavier things like tar sands. This is rather like the tar macadam that you get on the roads. So it's very thick and treacly. There are oil shales. And in fact, I cheated. This piece of coal is not a piece of coal. It's a piece of oil shale, but you'll see it's very much like coal. And it's a shale rock, which is compacted clay that's got oil embedded in it. And if you have a look at it, you'll see that it's dark on the outside, and that's the oil that's seeping out of the rock. And then there's gas hydrates. Gas hydrates are very interesting in that it's another source of gas like shale gas. This is gas that's actually surrounded by water molecules, rather like ice, and you find it in fairly shallow sediments under the sea or under the permafrost in the Arctic regions. And there's more gas in gas hydrates than all the gas put together in oil and gas reservoirs, shale gas, everywhere, to keep us going for 1,000 years at the current rate of consumption. The problem is it's very difficult to get out, because the gas hydrate that it's in, these snowballs of ice, are the glue that keep the rock together. And once you start to disturb the rock under the sea to get the gas out, you also cause subsidence and subsea volcanoes and tsunamis. And so the challenge is, can we get that gas out? It's rather like taking the top out of a champagne cork without actually disturbing the ground. And so that's a big challenge, but it's there again if we need it. So those are fossil fuels. And then we've got nuclear. Well, I was not allowed to bring my nuclear reactor along tonight. So here's nuclear. And a lot of controversy about nuclear, of course, and it's very variable where that's used. So the normal nuclear power comes from fission. This is the same type of nuclear power as that the atomic weapons were developed, and nuclear power for peaceful purposes, nuclear reactors. We've got conventional reactors that have been used for 50 years or more. And then we've got the more recent brand of reactors, advanced reactors, which the main difference from the reactors that were there in the 50s, 60s, 70s is that it produces far less nuclear waste. And people's concern about nuclear, apart from accidents, has been that we have this legacy of nuclear waste that we have to dispose of, and in the UK we've still got a lot of nuclear waste from our nuclear reactors that we've incarcerated in cement, but we haven't decided how we're going to dispose of it. So that's one of the concerns people have about using nuclear. And these advanced reactors only produce about 5% of the nuclear waste that the old things like pressurized water reactors produced. So I think the future for nuclear could be good as long as we can overcome a lot of the public concerns about safety, disposal and so on like that. And then there's nuclear fusion, which is unlike using plutonium or uranium as you do for fission, here you actually bring nuclei together and fuse them together and produce particles which emit energy. And nuclear fusion is probably about 35 years away. It's always been 35 years away, and I think it will continue to be 35 years away. I'm not very hopeful about, well, I'm a bit skeptical. And then on the right-hand side, we have renewable energy. Energy that we get from sources that we can, rather than fossil fuels where we're depleting this resource that's built up over millions of years, energy that comes from nature around us in different forms. So we have biofeedstocks, and biofeedstocks comes in many forms. It comes in terms of straw or waste materials from food, waste wood, sewage, all sorts of biofeedstocks that we can use. I'm afraid this came from a donkey sanctuary. But the thing about biofeedstocks is that photosynthesis has produced it and consumed carbon dioxide, and in burning it we release the carbon dioxide that was there that we took in to form it. And so plants and trees are very good at doing this, and we can get some organisms that reproduce very, very quickly. So it's, in a way, it's carbon neutral. Waste is a form, as I said, of biofeedstocks. Then we've got hydroelectric. We've got lots of ways of getting energy from water. Wave energy, tidal energy. And so my little model here is shown, demonstrates that by actually storing energy in rivers and then making use of the potential energy as that goes and drives turbines, that we can actually extract. Imagine that this turbine at the bottom, when it gets to you, is an electric generator generating electricity, and we're using water that's high up to send it to a lower level, and that produces the energy to drive, the potential energy in that water drives the turbines. And then sneaking in the middle there was wind. Now, I've got a very ingenious device here, which is a windmill. And there's not much wind in here, but it's actually got a photovoltaic cell on the top. So I put this in the sunlight when the sun was shining earlier in the day, and you may think this is a bit quirky, but you shine light on this and it drives the windmill, which is the wrong way around, isn't it? What we want to do is to the wind to go round and produce electricity rather than electricity producing the windmill. But it's a rather nice toy. And it combines the last two of our energies, one of which is wind, of which there's quite a lot in the UK, particularly on land. And though we don't have much sun, we have lots of wind. We have geothermal, which is drilling down into the earth. And as you get into the earth's crust, there's a lot of energy down there. And the closest I get, there's this spongy ball, which if you imagine at the center of this, there's lots of energy and we can drill down and produce the energy from the earth's crust. And then finally, of course, the solar. And whereas the others might have limitations, solar, we've got so much energy, solar energy coming down onto the Earth's surface that if only we could capture a small percentage of that in terms of our electricity and energy needs, then we would be okay for thousands of years, if not longer. And the only problem is with solar is that the other thing about fossil fuels, as well as producing energy, is that they produce all the materials that we take for granted around us. Plastics, chemicals, fuels, they all come from fossil fuels. So if we don't use fossil fuels because we're worried about the carbon, we have to find another way of providing the materials that we take for granted in terms of everyday life and that completely surround us. But solar, there's two ways of it capturing solar energy. One is thermal, where you use giant reflectors to actually capture the thermal energy from the sun and concentrate that heat energy into fluids that you heat up, and then they provide the ability to drive steam turbines and generate electricity in the usual way. Or there's photovoltaics, where we convert, that's in the top of this toy that's going round, these photovoltaics cells that take sunlight and convert the energy in sunlight to electrons into electricity. And that's probably the most direct way to do it. The problem is that these devices at the moment, very costly, and the efficiency of conversion of the energy in the sun to electrons is quite low at the moment. I mean, typically 10-15%, although there are experimental devices that go up to 30-40%, but the big challenge is to actually bring the cost down and to actually make the efficiency higher. So, those are the contenders, and this is my map of the energy landscape. And you can see that it's dominated in the middle by fossil fuels, that currently the world consumes about 15 terawatts a year, and that's 10 to the 15 watts per year. And of that, about 85% is fossil fuels. So we're very, very dependent on oil, coal, and gas. And then we have smatterings of the other energies around. Of course, nuclear is very patchy depending. Germany doesn't have any. France has 75% of its energy from nuclear. And what I've tried to estimate here is how much energy could we get from each of these sources, given that there are limitations on each of them. Biomass, for instance, you actually need land mass to grow it, and so there'll be a limitation on how much land we have available to actually grow fuel crops rather than food, for instance. And with wind, again, although there's plenty of wind, there is a limitation. They take up land space, and you can't put them maybe in the middle of urban areas. You have to put them in rural areas. So there are limitations on that. There are also limitations on where you can put your solar cells, of course, although the hope is that we'll get the efficiency of those up, and we can put those in, I suppose you can put windmills on your house, but technology that will convert windows and build in photovoltaics into window panes are going to be part of the future way that will capture the sun. So the main message I want to convey here with all these alternatives is that for various reasons, none of them are going to replace fossil fuels on their own. So we can get maybe 10-15% of our total energy needs from them, but we're not going to get 85-90%. And so until we can actually go to the point where solar is sufficiently affordable, large scale and efficient to provide most of our electricity energy needs, we're going to have this portfolio of energies where we try to ramp down using fossil fuels and we ramp up as much as we can the remainder, but each of them is going to provide 10-15%. So if we want to replace the fossil fuels, we've got to have 5 or 6 of these, and it'll be very geographical. Some countries have got big rivers with large drops, and so Brazil, for instance, got a lot of hydroelectric, as has New Zealand. And Norway. So we don't have much of that here. So the main message is that in going from fossil fuels dominated to how we transition to the rest, that there's no single solution, and we've got to get used to actually having a broad distribution of energy for several decades, I believe. Now, if you look at where we are now in terms of the amount of renewables compared with oil, gas, and coal, globally, I like this chart because it's nice and visual, and I haven't found one that's a better update of this from the 2010 International Energy Agency report, but it's probably gone up to about 12.5% now, but it's of that order, and so that fits in with the sort of 85% fossil fuels that I was talking about. And bioenergy is the dominant renewable that we use at the moment. You see the hydropower is quite a lot, and solar, even though it's the fastest growing, is still only less than 1% of our total global needs. So we're starting off from quite a small base here, and What I've shown you there with the landscape was how things are today. And of course, these are moving goalposts. It's not going to stay the same. So on this slide, I've illustrated some of the things that are going to affect world energy demand and national energy demand over the next few decades. First is the population. We've got 7 billion people roughly now. By 2030, we'll have roughly 8, and by 2050, 9. And so simply the number of people is going to consume more energy. And if you couple that with the fact that developing nations are very rapidly improving their economies and want the quality of life that the more developed nations have enjoyed for some time. And that's a force that can't be held back. And so if you combine those two things together, the estimates are that by 2050, rather than 15 terawatts per annum, we'll be using 30 globally. And so if we can't meet everything with some combination of renewable energies now, we certainly won't be, unless things accelerate very rapidly, be able to meet that by 2050. So, why is there this real concern that we've got to do something? Why not just stay with fossil fuels and that have powered us for the last 100 years and carry on that way? Well, of course, the answer is that the greenhouse gas emissions, there's now, I would say, incontrovertible evidence that man-made anthropogenic CO2 emissions are causing, that have risen inexorably since the Industrial Revolution, as we see on the right there. And this is data from the Mauna Loa Observatory since 1960, that those levels are up now over 400 parts per million in the atmosphere, with CO2 emissions up above 30 gigatons, that's 10 to the 9th tons of CO2 a year. And the effect of this is that the mean global temperatures have gone up by about 5.5 or 0.6 degrees, half a degree roughly. But if we don't do anything about it, it's going to go up by a factor of 10 by 2050 if we keep on this slope. Now, looking at graphs like that's a bit boring. So Ian, who's the speaker who's going to follow me, is now going to come and show you a couple of videos that perhaps make it a bit more graphic where the CO2 is coming from and what the effect is.
So this is a NOAA video, which is a model of the data we have. It shows you the CO2 in the globe. This is basically saying, 2014 is the hottest year on record. And this is introductory stuff by NOAA, but we'll flip over that to this here. So you see the globe, yellow and red, high CO2 emissions. And you see that it's mainly in the northern hemisphere versus the south. In the south, you see a lot of white, Mars. That's actually carbon monoxide, which isn't a scale for carbon monoxide. Is basically crude or carbon, which is basically forest fires. And what we have here is basically, 2007, China is the biggest emitter. But you get other countries, you see other areas with large amounts of CO2, mainly on the east coast of America, Europe, and Southeast Asia, which is the Middle East pretty big as well. Here's just highlighting the countries that are really vulnerable, those with very low coastlines, or ones that are particularly vulnerable to droughts, etc. And this is going to go into how the seasonal cycle throughout the year. As you see, it's getting redder and redder as it's going through the year. At the moment, we're just in May time, when we're getting the peak CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere. Then basically, the growth of the plants and also the oceans kicks in and starts absorbing the CO2 from the atmosphere to the degree. This is why the first time you saw a jet, there's variation in that graph, partly because of the annual cycle. Goes on.
Okay, should we skip to the other one?
So that shows where the major sources are, and it's the big industrialized nations that are the major culprits of this. But another issue, of course, is why should we in the UK feel particularly about this? Ian?
So this is an R model, it's again a bit of a basic model. These are all on YouTube. And basically what it shows you is where the CO2 has evolved from the Industrial Revolution onwards. So again, it starts way back in the Industrial Revolution. There's not much, it's like one.
See where it's coming from in the middle.
The fact is, it's quite amazing how long it stays within the UK and then within Europe. So we were looking for the Federation of China and saying, well, you've been the largest producer for 5 years, you should really be doing something with CO2 now. But really, for hundreds of years, we've been well embrace and produce the CO2. And people, this is still First World War now, and we're still the biggest producer. Germany obviously taking in. And then the US taking over, and then moving over now to Japan and then into China. And that's just a sort of graphical representation of who's been historically responsible for CO2 production in the world, and why the UK should take these guys.
Okay, thanks Ian. So that sets the scene in terms of that this CO2 stuff is really serious in terms of causing effects on climate change. And we've seen that currently we're stuck in the situation with fossil fuels producing most of our energy. Right, so if I just illustrate this in terms of some numbers. This is the global carbon emissions in gigatons of carbon. If you want the gigatons of CO2, you simply multiply this roughly by 4. At the start of the millennium, we were down at just under 8 gigatons of carbon a year, about 28 or something gigatons of CO2, and we were at 375 parts per million. And the hope then was that we could actually cap this at something like 400 parts per million. The red line at the top is what will happen if we do nothing and we just carry on as we are now. By 2050, we'll have 1,000 parts per million of CO2 in the atmosphere, and the mean global temperature rise will be between 4 and 6 degrees, according to the best models. The green line is the best case scenario that we now think we can meet, which is 450 parts per million, with a mean global temperature rise of about 2 degrees. There will be some effects of that, but with adaptation, we can probably adapt to that and control it. Of course, CO2 levels didn't stay at 375. In May 2013, they went sailing through the 400 parts per million level. And so it's going to be a challenge to cap it at 450. And if we don't cap it at 450, some people think that we've got to resign ourselves to 550, which is a higher mean temperature rise. I'm very optimistic that if we actually pull together and that the countries, say the Paris climate change talks later this year, actually really get their act together, that we can still meet this 450 parts per million scenario. And there's just a figure for you. Each one of you produces on average 10 tons of CO2 a year. So if you want to take something away tonight that you might do, have a look at your carbon footprint, and I'll give you some websites later that DEC, the Department of Energy and Climate Change, have some calculators where you can calculate the sort of carbon footprint. And so, you know, an individual challenge is, can you cut your carbon footprint down from 10 to something like 5 or 6? That would be a great contribution if we all did that. This shows how the energy mix is going to vary over the next 30 years, and if we go to 2050, it doesn't change very much. That with the best will in the world, because for reasons I'll explain in a minute, we can't introduce renewables quickly enough to mean that we can wean ourselves completely off fossil fuels, and that by 2030 there, we're still using well over 60% of our energy mix from oil, coal and gas. And so this is not saying that we haven't got the will to introduce renewables, it's the rate of technology deployment and the cost of them relative to other energy sources is going to mean that it's not going to happen overnight, even if we continue to put a lot of subsidies and a lot of development into those areas. The dotted line, interestingly, shows how economic levers, if we have the will, can change things. That's what would have happened if we hadn't had the global economic recession in 2008. And so there was a reduction in energy use because we all had less money to spend and the economies were deflated. So that just shows if we deliberately use economic levers rather than inadvertently in that case, that there are ways that we can actually use less energy, which is one of the things that we need to do. And this is just a similar plot for the UK. The projection is that by 2030 we will indeed be using less energy, but we'll still be using at least 60% in the best scenarios of fossil fuels. So why can't a lot of these renewables be introduced more quickly? Well, there's a number of reasons. One is that a lot of them are in a state of developing technology and improving energy efficiency. And you can throw money at it, but the rate of technology development is finite in terms of being able to scale things up to higher levels. And we've got to bring the cost down, and I believe the cost that we've got to compare it with, so it's economically competitive without subsidies, is not the cost of fossil fuels on their own, but the cost of fossil fuels with carbon capture and storage, where we're taking the carbon out, because that's the real cost of carbon, of fossil fuels. Availability. I've said that there are limitations on biofuels, on wind, in terms of how much of this we can actually, in any country, deploy. And a major thing, of course, is intermittency. And in this country, the wind blows almost all the time, but the sun doesn't shine very often. And other countries have other combination problems of that. So our ability to actually store energy that's produced from these intermittent sources so that we can actually release it, obtain it when it's there and release it when we want it, is a technology that really is not up to the standards that we need it at the moment. And it's one of the big technological challenges, I think, of the next few decades, is to be able to actually have batteries that can operate at the grid level. We're all very used to using our mobile phones, and we take battery technology for granted in terms of our lifestyles. But doing this on a huge gigawatt scale is a real challenge, and that's what's needed. And then nuclear has its problems of its own in terms of accidents set nuclear technology back 10 years. It's difficult if people build reactors on seismic faults. There's the waste disposal legacy that we talked about, and of course there's the concerns about proliferation. But you know, it's interesting that France and Germany are neighbours, and one uses none and one uses a lot. This is very dependent on the national politics. And just to show you that my assertion that renewables are not going to be introduced overnight, as a lot of people would like it, I would be only too pleased if we could transform to 100% renewables tomorrow. This is the roadmap of the solar industry itself, which shows that by 2050, the projection is that solar PV will only provide 11% of the global energy market, such is the rate of progress and upscaling that's needed in that area. And this is a curve that shows a lot of those, all of those renewable energies, on where they are in terms of the maturity of the technology now compared with where we need to be in 2050. So hopefully by 2050, a lot of these will be moving up this curve, but a lot of the bioenergies and the solar and wind power is in the lower stages of development rather than approaching maturity. So I'm nearing the end of my talk. I'm just going to show you now what can we do about this. This dilemma that we need to continue to use fossil fuels, but it produces CO2 and some of the alternatives aren't available in sufficient volume. Well, this is another version of the CO2 plot. The top boundary is business as usual. If we do nothing and we go to that 1,000 parts per million, today we have about 32 gigatons of CO2 per annum. By 2050, we'll have over 60. And the bottom boundary is what we need to do to meet this 450 scenario where we keep mean temperatures down, rises down to 2 degrees. And that shows that by 2050, we've got to decrease our emissions of CO2 down to about 14. So the difference between what we will do if we do nothing and what we need to do is about 50 gigatons, 50 times 10 to the 9 trillion tons of CO2. We've got to take out of the system by 2050 compared with what we would do if we did nothing. And what this chart shows is that there's different ways to do it. Now, if you take the bottom 50%, these are all to do with basically being more efficient with the use of energy. Either we use less energy, or we have cars that do 70 miles to the gallon rather than 30, or we have buildings that are very much better insulated, and that we generally are better citizens at using energy, and we only use the minimum amount of energy for different applications. This is low-lying fruits that we can do now. A lot of there will be technological improvements that help us, but there are schemes to encourage people to use less energy, but do we actually use them all, and are they effective enough? The next 30% is a combination of renewables and nuclear. So that will grow, and that will take out 30% of this extra 50 gigatons of CO2. But that doesn't account for everything. So the extra, the last 20%, which is 10 gigatons per annum, that's a lot of carbon dioxide. If we continue to use fossil fuels as we must, we've got to capture 10 gigatons of CO2 a year out of the system and store it rather than emit it to the atmosphere. So carbon capture and storage is something that my colleague Ian is going to tell you more about in the next talk, so I'm not going to dwell on it too much. But there are a lot of myths about carbon capture and storage, one of which is that the technology isn't ready. The technology has been used in the oil and chemical industries for 50 years. And the second thing is that we can't use it because you can't capture all the CO2 we produce and bury it. Well, this shows that we don't need to capture all the CO2. If we actually are good citizens in terms of using less energy, that we introduce renewables and nuclear as fast as we can, we only need to store about 10 gigatons, one-fifth of the total amount that we would have produced. And this is the carbon capture and storage that Ian's going to tell you about, where basically you capture CO2, you transport it, and then you store it in underground reservoirs. And he will tell you more about that. But I just want to make two points. There is a cost to this. It costs us to do that process, and we need energy to do it. So the net effect is that energy and electricity prices could go up by as much as 25% by using fossil fuels plus CCS compared with not using CCS. So there's no free lunch or free beer. But electricity prices will rise anyway as we go to use renewables. These will be more expensive routes to energy and fuels as we remove subsidies that a lot of these benefit from now. And so a message I want to convey to you is that the days of cheap energy are over, and it's something that our politicians, it's a message that they don't necessarily like to convey, because they ride on a ticket they're going to keep energy prices down. And I believe that there's an inexorable force that will mean that energy prices have to increase. So we have a choice. Either we postpone that, and we postpone what we need to do to actually take CO2 out of the atmosphere. So it's not our problem, it's the next generation, and governments like passing things on to the next government. So the question I put to you is, would you be prepared to spend 25% more now on your electricity if it meant that your grandchildren will not have to suffer from the extremities of climate change, that we won't suffer, and my children probably won't suffer, but certainly my grandchildren will? Or do we want to heap all the cost and all the bad effects that will have on quality of life several generations down the line? That's the important decision I think we've all got to think about. And there is a cost of delaying introducing CO2 capture and storage. There's an article on the right there that's a cross-party Carbon Connect report, which I rather like simply because it manages to get all the energies I've talked about into the word electricity. And you see storage is at the top. There's a couple of studies. In the UK, if we delay introducing CCS, it's cheaper to do it now, and there are many economic reports that show if we act quickly, the costs will be lower and gradual. If we delay that, it's going to cost us an extra £30 to £50 billion by 2050. The US study has shown that if we don't introduce carbon capture and storage, electricity prices by 2050 will go up over 200%. But if we do, we'll still go up, because things will inflate and it will get more expensive, but they'll only go up by 80%. And the reason for that is that if we if we don't introduce CCS, and we still try to meet our carbon targets, we'll have to introduce renewable energies before they're ready and they're more expensive. And so CCS is not only the sensible thing to do, integrated over time, it's the best cost-effective option. So this is my final thing I want to say. How do we actually live with fossil fuels but actually keep our carbon levels within this 450 envelope? Well, the low-lying fruit at the top is we use less energy. The next thing is we use more gas, because gas only emits 50% of the CO2 per unit of energy compared with coal and oil. And so I think using more and more gas for power and everything and domestically is absolutely essential. We then capture as much of the CO2 as we can. We increase the use of nuclear. I think nuclear has got to play a far bigger role in the future than it has in the past. And we continue to actually go from fossil fuels to renewables as quickly as we possibly can, but I hope I've shown you that that's going to take decades. It's not something that's going to happen by the end of this decade. And meanwhile, we deplete our resources as slowly as possible. And we've got these non-conventional hydrocarbons there, the shale gas, the tar sands, and the gas hydrates. So Fred Princeton is there because just as the Stone Age didn't end because we ran out of stone, the fossil fuel era will not end because we run out of fossil fuels. It will run out because we choose to make decisions to transfer to other greener and hopefully more affordable forms of energy in time. And this slide just tells us what is the challenge for carbon capture and storage. We've currently globally got about 20 projects storing 1 million tonnes of CO2 a year. To meet that 10 gigatons by 2050, we need over 3,000 projects by 2050. So that means we've got to introduce beyond 2020 roughly 100 of these projects a year across the globe to do it. In the UK, we have two. The government is sponsoring two in a competition, and we probably need about between 5 and 10 here as our contribution to that. So, you know, this is not going to be easy, but I think it does need people to actually press the point that unless we do something now, the longer we delay it, the more difficult and the more expensive and the more costly to future generations it's going to be. So as we go to a new scenario where fossil fuels, I believe, won't disappear completely, but we're dominated by solar. Are fossil fuels and avoiding climate change compatible? Yes, they are. But we need to take action, and it will cost us money to do that. Thanks very much for your attention tonight. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So now is the time to ask the expert. So if you have any questions, please raise your hand.
What's the potential mix like in the UK and potential resources available? Because you showed for the world as a whole, solar, obviously that's a fair amount less here in the UK. What would kind of decarbonise the cost effectiveness?
Right, so I think we're going, I think, you know, the current scenario is that we'll use more biofuels and that we will continue to invest in wind. So you can see every time you drive through rural areas, there are more wind farms going up. We will do our best to actually capture what solar we can. And it's not negligible, but it's not like other countries. So we will, I think, compared with some countries, have quite a diverse mix. And I believe that, in fact, we've neglected nuclear far too long. We now reach the point where a third of our nuclear capacity is going to be decommissioned shortly because they've reached the end of their lifetime. It takes 10 years to plan and build a nuclear reactor. And so even if we make decisions now, then it's going to be some time before we can increase our nuclear capability or get it back to what it is now. But I do believe that will be an important part of the future as well for the UK.
Next question.
Talking about nuclear, you may be referring to, of course, uranium-based reactors, but could have thorium-based ones. How soon do you see that type of reactor coming online? It's got far, does it have the issues of security and wasting quite the same way?
These are quite complex issues. People think, the nuclear energy, the ores are there. Of course, there is an increasing issue about the amount of uranium available. And I think thorium reactors are, being in a state of development. And I think we will see thorium reactors taking over. The advanced reactors, pebble bed reactors and advanced gas reactors are much more efficient. And so I think we will make the nuclear fuel go further, but I think we're going to see a combination of different types of reactor. And but I think we need to be look far more carefully at A, the availability of are there energy security issues in terms of the availability of that? People often neglect that, and also the cradle to grave analysis of nuclear. It's not zero carbon because there's energy emitted in terms of mining the ore and all the construction costs and everything else. But I think, you know, it's certainly on the low side compared with some of the alternatives.
About fusion. So,
yeah.
Right.
Well,
optimistic.
You know, it's not my area, so I can't comment from a professional technology point of view on that. I just feel that the challenges are enormous, and we may have a viable reactor at scale on that time scale. But the, you know, in terms of actually having a sustainable fusion loop, I think until that can be demonstrated at the large scale, I think we still need to be cautious about how quickly this can be deployed. Because you know, I've said that fission reactors take 10 years to be deployed. I think for them to be a solution, if we cracked on that time scale some of the technology problems, the deployment will probably take us well into the second half of this century. So I hope it's part of the long-term solution, but I don't, on the time scales I'm talking of getting between now and 2050 and into 26, the second half of the century, I don't believe that they'll be a major contributor, but I'm happy to be proved wrong.
One last question.
You spoke about solar and like what the renewables being really expensive and part of that to do the subsidy. I was just going to ask, like, when you like include that in the price of tier for the subsidy, if you were to include the cost of subsidy for other fossil fuels, they also like to increase massively, or if you were to include the cost of future damage, they would increase a lot too. If we sort of realigned how we see fossil fuels and renewables, would that speed up the
No, I mean, I think at the moment the governments across the world are using different kinds of subsidy to encourage people to actually invest in renewables, especially solar, to actually try and improve scalability and bring costs down. So it's a case of getting technology from the sort of demonstration stage into commercial. And the way they do it in this country is by guaranteed electricity prices in the future, saying that in return for this investment that you're making, we will give you some guarantee that you will get a return, so you can have a business model that you know where you stand. And whereas the you know, the so-called subsidies for fossil fuels are maybe tax incentives for people to operate in the North Sea and things like that. So I think if we were at a point where the subsidies were actually not enough to actually, if you like, saturate the renewables market in terms of the people, there's a case for looking at some redistribution. But and this will be very country dependent, of course, in terms of how much fossil fuel you need to top up. Just come back from New Zealand, they only need about 20% fossil fuel to top up their renewables into their energy in terms of what they got. So I think the issue of subsidies is very complicated in that you're trying to actually do several things with them. You're trying to get more people to actually invest in renewables. You know, my belief is there isn't a level playing field, because where the subsidies are really needed for fossil fuels is to invest in carbon capture and storage, because the only way that they're acceptable is to take the carbon out. And so why there isn't more activity to either put a carbon tax in place or to get carbon trading markets where there's a real cost on carbon effective. The EU has one, but I mean the price is 16, 18 euros, something like that, which means it's still much cheaper to emit the CO2 than to actually pay for the trading. So I think governments have got to actually have global agreements of where we're going to go to collectively, and then each country has got to actually say what's their contribution to the carbon emissions, and they've got to decide how this combination of subsidies for different things is going to get us there sooner, because the market certainly won't get us there.
How about this? We'll have a lot of time after this to get directly ask the questions.
Can we have another big round of applause for Professor?